Hello and welcome to the St. Louis Art Museum's Art Speaks program. My name is Jessica Kennedy and I'm the educator for adult learning at the museum. Before we begin, please familiarize yourself with the Q&A section located on your screen. Feel free to enter your questions at any time during the program and we will choose a few to answer at the end. Also, there is live auto transcription available for this program. Please click the CC icon to activate or deactivate the subtitles. For today's talk, Uncovering the Life of Artist Simhah Viterbo, we are joined by Genevieve Cortinovis, the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation Associate Curator of Decorative Arts and Design. Thanks so much for being here today, Jenny.
Hi, I'm thrilled to be here. So without further ado, I'll dive into this installment of Art Speaks, Uncovering the Life of the Artist Simhah Viterbo. So Simhah Viterbo is the maker of this extraordinary object, an embroidered Torah art curtain signed in the year 5515 or 1754-55 in the Gregorian calendar in Ancona, Italy. So this talk coincides with the exhibition Signed in Silk, introducing a sacred Jewish textile, which is on now until October 3rd in Gallery 100, which is SLAM's dedicated textile gallery. And if you feel comfortable, I encourage you to go see it because there's nothing like seeing these objects in person. But for the next 30 to 40 minutes, I invite you to join me on a journey back to a bustling city on the turquoise waters of the Adriatic Sea, where in the middle of the 18th century, a young artist of only 15 or 16, enduring political and economic discrimination, accomplished something truly extraordinary. So we'll start with the who, the what, the where, and we'll finish with a more speculative why. So the largest and most conspicuous of synagogue textile furnishings, the Torah curtain or parochet hung in front of or sometimes inside the Torah ark, an ornate cabinet that houses the sacred Torah scrolls or the first five books of the Hebrew Bible, and thus acts as the focal point of prayer in the synagogue. So Italian Jewish women like Simhah were celebrated makers of these often very sumptuous textiles. There's even a special prayer in the Italian rite that honors, and I quote, every daughter of Israel who makes a mantle or cover with which to adorn the Torah. Part of what makes this object so special is that, of course, it's not only very beautiful and complex, but it's also signed and dated about someone who we were able to uncover something about, which is actually quite unusual. So SLAM purchased this curtain in 2019 with the Deanne and Paul Schatz Endowment Fund for Judaica. And although the curtain had been published and exhibited at major museums in New York, Paris, and Jerusalem, the identity of the maker had not yet been established when SLAM purchased the curtain. And although it had long been thought to have come from Ancona, there was really no smoking gun to prove this. So my first research task was to find the life dates and home of this particular Simhah Viterbo. And thankfully, I was able to do so virtually, primarily through COVID lockdown, through a crowdsourced genealogical website, the Central Archives of the History of the Jewish People in Jerusalem, the writing of Simhah's own son, and of course, through Simhah's own words on the curtain itself. And here they are, handwork of the young woman, Simhah Viterbo, in the year of the straight and the good. So if we have Hebrew readers, you might already know this, and this is more information than you need. But within the text, you'll see a double appellation, Bashara, which is a young woman, and Mara, which is Mrs. And that is actually amongst Italian Jewry, describing an unmarried young woman. So this gave us some clue about her position. And then the date is given as a chronogram, and that can be understood using the gematria system of Jewish numerology, by which a letter in the Hebrew alphabet corresponds to a numerical value. I was super excited to learn this because is there anything better than an ancient cipher, really? So the curtain uses the marks above the letters, in this case, I'll see if I can get my mouse over here, right here, to indicate the letters that should be counted. And so in this case, it's Yashar, which equals 515 with the 5,000 implied. And then this translates to 1754-55, making her about 15 or 16 when she made the curtain, which is pretty amazing. So the winning Simhah, so to speak, was born on June 10th, 1779 to Solomon Moisey Viterbo and a mother who's unfortunate, whose name we don't know yet. Maybe we will uncover at some point. And she died on June 8th in 1779. Her father was a rabbi, a small scale wool importer probably, and a student of the famous rabbi and physician, Samson Marpurgo, who is one of the famous, most famous rabbis to come out of Ancona. Simhah married Mordecai and had at least three children, her first in 1764 and her last in 1767. And unfortunately, only one of the, those children survived into adulthood. And then, as I mentioned, she died at the age of 40, leaving a 12-year-old son, Vitali, or Yahyahim Viterbo, who would go on to become a noted rabbi and poet. And I included here just a few other images, objects really that are associated with her family that she may have seen in her lifetime. Actually, the one on the right is not, but it shows the kind of continuation of her family's sort of material culture. So the object on the left is a Hebrew book printed in Venice that belonged to her father. And these so-called gate pages really influenced the design of Torah arks and ketubah, which are illustrated Jewish marriage contracts. And it's probably also Torah ark curtains. So that's interesting to note. And then the object on the right is actually the ketubah of her son. And just take note of this tiny little grapevine up here, which you also see on the Torah ark itself. Grape vitae, possibly a reference to Viterbo, like a family crest that was reused. One of the most exciting discoveries of the research was this passage from an introduction written by Simhah's son in 1818. And it was published in Rashi script, which is a Sephardic script typically used in rabbinical treaties. And so it was really only with the great help of a very, very generous colleague at Washington University that this touching tribute was revealed to me. And when I received the translation via email one Tuesday night, I literally jumped up and down. I was so ecstatic, primarily for three reasons. The first was that it really confirmed Simha's identity. This was the right Simhah. And then it gave us a glimpse into who she was as a person, you know, a devoted and beloved mother. And then third, it really celebrated her outstanding artistry and called her an artist in her own right. And so I can read it for you just because it's so beautiful. I was a child, tender, and my mother's only, and together we used to have great fun every day. She was taken from me when I was almost 14. A woman of valor, of many talents, the splendor of man. She kept order among many different things. The work of her hands was magnificent, words cannot describe. Female wisdom built her house with works of art, embroidery in silver and in gold, more valuable than pearls, for the grandeur of the sanctuary and the court. So each line of this passage actually makes a biblical reference, and several SLAM colleagues have noted the allusions to Proverbs 31, particularly the verse, a woman of valor, which is traditionally read by a husband to his wife at Friday evening Shabbat dinner, and also at the funerals of women. So it's really interlaced with all this wonderful biblical religious imagery. But then also, I think this lovely phrase of, we used to have great fun every day. And you don't always think about, you know, in the 18th century, a mother and child having a wonderful time, you know, having great fun every day. I think that's kind of it really touched me. I have to say, when I read it, I could only hope that my own children would say that about me one day. So I wanted to dive into the artistry behind this and think about the materials and techniques. So I've included this image from Diderot's Encyclopédie to demonstrate some of the basic tools necessary to complete such an embroidery. So as you can see, first the base fabric was stretched on a frame. And so the design was temporarily applied by pouncing, which is when chalk is pushed through a pricked design. And then wool, felt, and vellum sections were applied because this is a result of both applique and direct embroidery. And then finally, the last stage is the silk shadings, the polychrome flowers that you see on the curtain. And you can see you can accomplish this type of embroidery, although it's very complex, with not too many different tools and in a relatively small space. So this could be accomplished, for instance, in a domestic setting. So here are some detailed images taken by SLAM textile conservator Miriam Murphy of the curtain itself. And I'm really thrilled to have them because I think it helps you understand the three-dimensionality of the work itself. So here's an example of purl, which is when metal wires are usually wrapped around a needle and then to create a kind of a spiral and then couch down to the surface itself. And it creates a really, really interesting texture. There's also passing threads. So these are threads that are a core of silk or sometimes linen, and then they're wrapped with a wire. So this becomes, and they can either be couched or actually sewn through. Here's an example of different elements of couching. So you can see here, they're actually just strips, metal strips that have been applied. On the left in particular, you can see that, and then sewn to the surface of the base fabric. And then here you can see the variety of substrates that give the work quite a lot of dimension, as I mentioned. It's really almost like low relief. It's yarn, wool felt, and vellum. And then you can see a little bit of the silk shading peeking out over here on the left-hand side. So where? I had not really ever heard of Ancona, I have to confess, before I first started researching this curtain. And I had the chance to visit in 2019, actually on a family trip. I was visiting very dear friends of ours that happened to live in the Marche. And so I went to Ancona to see the city, and this is right when we had just gotten the curtain. So it was quite exciting. It's a really beautiful port city on the Adriatic coast. It's Jewish community, like other Jewish communities in Italy, was comprised of three main cultural groups. So that's Sephardic, Italianate, and Ashkenazic Jews. So Italian Jews, in some cases, trace their heritage back to the Roman Empire. Ashkenazic Jews came from southern Germany, Eastern Europe, and areas of France. And then Sephardic Jews largely arrived after 1492, fleeing persecution and eventual expulsion from Spain and Portugal. And in some cases, they came actually through Sicily and Naples as well. So with them came increased trade with the East. And I show you some of the trade routes or major traders with Ancona in this map via the red arrows. So this is mostly thanks to familial networks that were established by Sephardic Jews across the Ottoman Empire. In the 18th century, it was a papal state, really with a well-established community of Jews. And they were mostly merchants and traders. So like Venice, Ancona emerged in the 16th century as one of the first European cities to have a merchant colony from the Ottoman empires. And this was also primarily composed of Greek and Jewish traders. So they long had this well-established trade network that was only further accentuated and improved with more Jews leaving other areas of Europe and moving to Ancona throughout the 14th to 18th century. So as a papal state, Ancona was under the direct sovereign rule of the Pope. And in 1555, the papal bull Cumnimus Absurdum, among other indignities, severely restricted the professional and economic freedom of Jews living in the papal states, forcing most into just a few predominantly low-paying trades, like secondhand textile dealing, requiring them to wear a discriminatory sartorial marker, and most critically segregating them in ghettos, which at this time were enclosed and locked neighborhoods. So though expressly prison neighborhoods, scholars have suggested that these ghettos also paradoxically offered security from what had been a constant threat of expulsion. And this continuity of place, coupled with the forced isolation of diverse communities of Jews, together in a kind of confined area, resulted in an increase in Jewish institutions and ceremonial art. And here you can see this on the right is an image of the exterior of the Levantine and Italian synagogue in Ancona, which I took on this 2019 visit. The Levantine synagogue was established in its current location in 1879. And then the Italian synagogue, including its Torah ark and all of its furnishings, including quite a big textile collection, was moved to the ground floor of the building in 1933 after its original Baroque building was demolished for an infrastructure project. So both the Levantine and Italian synagogues now exist in the same building. And this on the left, painting of a synagogue interior from the 17th century, shows a red curtain, which is hanging from the Torah arc, visible on the right side of the painting. So that's a Torah arc curtain, and you can see its positioning within the main prayer hall. And then the women look on from an elevated gallery. So women were not allowed in the main prayer hall. They had a separate section. And then the men, as you can see here, wear yellow hats. And that's one of those discriminatory mandates. And this is why scholars believe that this particular painting depicts a synagogue in a papal state, because that was where these discriminatory mandates were was widely practiced. So documentary evidence suggests that precious textiles, including curtains, mantles, or covers, and wrappers had probably been in use in Italy from the Middle Ages. And so I show you here an image from the Rothschild Mazor showing a Torah mantle from the 15th century. In the 16th and early 17th centuries, embroidered synagogue textiles really had a direct relationship to popular pattern books and tended to reflect domestic textiles like table covers, sometimes swaddling bands, circumcision bands. The textiles became increasingly complex in the late 17th and early 18th century. And you might compare, for instance, Viterbo's Torah curtain to this Torah wrapper made in Ancona in 1672 by Livia Sapili. And this is one of the only textiles that is documented to have been made in Ancona that is actually outside of Ancona itself. This is at the Museum of Italian Jewish Art in Jerusalem. Synagogue textiles were frequently created in coordinated sets. And actually, we know, thanks to the research of a colleague in Israel, Joya Perugia, that Viterbo embroidered a mantle in 1750 and a binder, which is a strip of cloth used to secure the rolled Torah scrolls in 1758. Unfortunately, we don't know what these look like, but they do still survive in a private collection. So perhaps one day we will find sort of, or be able to trace her artistic development over the course of a decade. You can see here that they, particularly the mantles, have a direct relationship to synagogue silver. So you can see this wonderful illustration that shows a variety of different synagogue textiles with the rimonim or Torah finials kind of peeking up through that. And then here's an image from the 19th century, but showing a synagogue possibly in Italy, or definitely in Italy, showing all the different kind of variety of textiles that you might have, that you can imagine. And the Torah being processed with, you know, covered by a Torah mantle and also capped by these Torah finials. So onto the why, as in why does this textile look the way it does? So I'm gonna show you a few objects in Sam's collection and elsewhere that might help explain this. But first, it's really important to understand the role of Jewish women in the textile industry in Italy. And I'll give you four quotes here. Some are actually written by Jewish people themselves and some not, and they have a slight undercurrent of anti-Semitism, I have to say, but they show this observations of women's work in the textile industry in the ghettos at various moments in the 18th and 19th century. So it's interesting to note that the bulk of Italian Jewish women did work in the 18th century, and then most but not all worked in the textile trade as expert menders, dressmakers, embroiderers, buttonhole makers, shopkeepers. About 40% of women earned the funds for their own dowries, which were substantially larger than their Christian counterparts in most cases. And actually, women in the Marche region, where Ancona is, had particularly lavish dowries that included dresses and textiles, jewelry, books, etc. 70% of the sort of secondhand, or of the secondhand trade, or was composed of clothing and textiles. And so women's time, skill, and artistry in transforming merchandise, like mending, modernizing, embellishing, really was essential to the economic engine of the ghetto. And so here are three kind of quotes that give you a sort of sense, right? So they were working all day long and all night under the, you know, weak candlelight, poor lighting. And this is interesting because this is from Bernardino Ramazzini, who was oftentimes called the father of occupational medicine. So he was interested in how someone's profession affected their health and other diseases that they might suffer from. Gregorovius, he describes the Roman ghetto, which of course is slightly different than the Ancona ghetto, but, you know, as the entire world of shredded fabric flutters. Velvets, golden fringes, odd bits in red, azure, turquoise, black, or white. And then down here, actually, the kind of words, probably through a notary, of Jewish women. So in the case on the left, this is actually a woman who lived around the same time that Simhah did. Presumably they knew each other, possibly, in the 18th century. And she used to assist in the shop of her husband, Gabriel. And unfortunately, he had suffered a misfortune, is how they describe it. And he needed an infusion of money for their shop, 300 scudi. And it mentions here that she had acquired all the skills she needed working in the shop to negotiate such a loan. In fact, she used her own dowry as a collateral for this loan. And then it mentions also the kind of textiles that we're selling, which is really interesting, new and old linen, so not just secondhand. Laces, Indian, which that would be textiles that are coming from India or imitating them, usually printed or painted cottons, half wools, stockings, and others. And then finally here, which I really like, this is from Turin from 1720. This is a woman who, you know, had procured over several years with her sweat, labor, toil, and industry, you know, the money that was needed for her dowry. And therefore she decided that when she died, she wanted, you know, everything to go to her husband and not to her relatives. So showing some interesting agency as well, I think. So understanding how important the secondhand textile industry was, and really just the textile industry in general, to these Jewish communities, I wanted to kind of consider what kind of textiles might have been passing through Ancona at this particular moment. And I did that, I started to really think using our own collection. Museum has an encyclopedic collection of textiles. It's a little idiosyncratic. It has certain strengths and weaknesses, but you are able to kind of reconstruct through, using our collection, the type of textiles one might have had, or the sort of type of collection of textiles one might have seen in one's lifetime in the mid 18th century in Italy. And so here is a typical jardiniere velvet, or Genoa velvet for the name of the city where it was traditionally or first made. And so this is a polychrome cut and uncut velvet that was used predominantly for furnishing fabrics, but in other cases as well. And it has this wonderful, very robust, stylized, but also very controlled design. It's really more Baroque, although it was made really into the 19th century, and it had moments of popularity throughout about 300 years. And I show you here a engraving, a parterre de broderie, which is actually, so this is a garden bed essentially, to show you how this type of Baroque garden design might have influenced the design of these textiles, which are very, they're centrally, you know, they're symmetrical on a central axis. They have wonderful foliage and flowers, but you can't quite identify what is what. They're not technically accurate. They're much more stylized. And there are parts of that in Simhah's curtain, I would say. In fact, how do we describe the central motif in her curtain? Is it a stack of baskets? Is it a fountain? Is it a tree of life? It's a little bit hard to describe, and so but it's very much controlled and stylized and, you know, on this central axis, and includes some of these very, you know, exuberant types of foliage and flowers too. These types of cut and uncut velvets, Genoa velvets, show up on Torah art curtains of the 18th century frequently. So here's an example from the Jewish Museum in Rome, for instance. I also wanted to think about fashionable dress silks. So what are the kind of fashionable silk, dress silks that one might have seen in the middle of the 18th century? And I've kind of taken a longer look here because of the idea that it's the secondhand textile trade and that these patterns are popular in the secondhand trade for quite a long time. So here is a silk petticoat, essentially. So it's a series of joined panels of silk fabric that are woven à la disposition. So that's woven for a specific purpose. And in this case, it's the skirt of a dress. And you can see this is like the Genoa velvet, still quite a structured design. It has these wonderful kind of lacy bands coming through it. And that's why these designs are sometimes called lace pattern silks, although they don't really have anything to do with lace, actual lace patterns of the mid 18th century, or the, you know, first quarter of the 18th century. However, the flowers start to get a little bit more delicate, a little bit more potentially botanically specific. And I thought that was interesting to contrast kind of 20 years later. You see the sort of high Rococo naturalism in fashionable textile design. And so here's an example with these wonderful Hogarthian lines of beauty, these curves rather than straight lines. And the flowers are very specific. That's a tulip, that's, you know, campanula, that's a carnation, a bellflower. Like, you know, they're very specific. This is a piece of holly. And that was influenced by the popularity of both drawing books and botanical illustrations that were making their way around Europe in the 17th and 18th century. And it's funny because Simhah's curtain has elements of this earlier moment, as I described, a bit symmetrical and controlled, but then she also includes really wonderful naturalistic flowers in the silk shading. And I wanted to show you here another Torah curtain. This is in the collection of the Jewish Museum in Rome. And you can see it's probably a petticoat that's been repurposed, or a skirt panel that's been repurposed. And then you can see in this painting by François Dutoit that this is what a dress might have looked like with this elaborately either embroidered or woven border à la disposition. And here you are, two different potentially petticoats or dress panels. So we also see quite a lot of Torah art curtains that are made from these naturalistic dress silks that have, in some cases, botanically specific flowers, and that probably came from the kind of middle to the late 18th century. And so here again are two examples from the Jewish Museum in Rome. They have one of the best collections of Torah art curtains in the world, so that's why I'm showing so many of them. Interestingly, these have the Decalogue. So this is a commandments on a cloud of glory, and then an inscription here. You also might consider the influence of Christian ecclesiastical textiles. So this is an example, a chasuble in the collection of the Diocese of Ancona from the mid 18th century. Again, it includes these very botanically specific flowers. It has more of these Hogarthian curves, right? It has a little lambrequin at the bottom, these tassel punctuated draperies, which actually show up arguably on the top of Simhah's curtain. And then it's also a mix, right, of silver and gold and also polychrome silk shading. So there are some similarities in terms of the technique and also the design. And then you might also think about the influence of ketubah. So Ancona was a major producer of illustrated Jewish marriage contracts. And they have a few different programs with a lot of variation, so design programs that were used repeatedly. And this is one, for instance. And this, of course, has beautiful, delicate painting and also very botanically specific flowers. So as I mentioned earlier, Ancona emerged in the 16th century as one of the first European cities to have a merchant colony from the Ottoman territories. And, Ancona, really in the 16th century, the trade network has extended all the way from Lyon to in the west to the Ottoman Empire in the east. And then these trade connections really persisted. Interestingly, in 1732, it was declared a free port. So that's a port that's open to captains or merchants from any nation, luring them with customs-free sale, storage, and re-export of goods. And so while economic historian Luca Andreoni, who is actually teaches at a university in Ancona, suggested the city's new status did not particularly benefit Jewish traders since it attracted French and English competition, it resulted in an influx of goods and people from across Europe and the East. According to to Andreoni, from 1737 to 38, so this is just before Simhah made her curtain, the greatest number of ships with orders from Anconite Jews overwhelmingly came from Magusa, which is present-day Dubrovnik, or centers around present-day Dubrovnik, just across the Adriatic Sea. Closely followed by Thessaloniki, which is in Greece and had a major Jewish population, and then finally Istanbul. And these orders included tobacco, wool, raw cotton, and textiles. And so it's interesting to consider how textiles made in the Ottoman Empire might have influenced Simhah's design. And I start with this one, which is a really interesting object in Sam's collection, which is featured in Science and Silk. So this is a couple columned prayer rug from the 18th century. And this design, it's proposed by scholars like Walter Denny and Vivian Mann, that the couple column motif was actually not sort of native to mainland Turkey, but was rather brought there from Jewish weavers fleeing Spain. They suggested that the couple column is actually a characteristic of Nazareth architecture, which is the area of southern Spain, and that this motif was then incorporated into prayer carpet design, which is quite interesting. So showing the influence of the Jewish diaspora from a very early moment, into the 18th century. also interesting to consider other Torah arcs, curtains that are actually just pile carpets, so woven pile carpets, and that incorporate similar motifs. So here's one from Turkey and another one, the earliest extant Torah arc curtain in Italy is this pile carpet, which was probably made, I believe, in Egypt for the Italian market, around 1500. Simhah's own curtain has these enclosed borders and also a very kind of exuberant central motif. And so in a way, the format is similar to the prayer carpet itself. You might also think about Ottoman embroidery and other kinds of embroidered Torah arc curtains that were made not in Italy, but in areas of the Ottoman Empire. So for instance, this example on the left in the Jewish Museum in New York incorporates quite a lot of the same techniques that Simhah's curtain has, but has a slightly different composition, but still with the enclosed borders. And again, with this kind of flowering tree of life motif in the center. Small domestic textiles like this entered Europe beginning in the 17th century, along with coffee. And so you might imagine the influence of Ottoman embroidery on especially Eastern Italian embroidery of that moment. And then not to be too simplistic, but sort of A plus B equals C, you know, there are elements of this embroidery and elements of this couple column prayer rug that sort of combined seem to equal this wonderful embroidered example, right? The color, the carnations, the cypress trees, and then the overall composition. And then finally, I wanted to think about the influence of textiles further away, including palimpsests, which are some bed covers or wall hangings that came from India. They're more typically painted on cotton, but in this case, this is actually embroidered, probably in Gujarat, or Kutch, which is in Gujarat on the western coast of India, for the European market. And it incorporates a tree of life, which itself is a sort of mashup of Persian and Chinese and Indian and European sources, but is set within these wonderful floral enclosed borders as well. And you can see the Torah arc curtain right here in the back, the broquette, and even together, when you see them side by side, you start to sort of see some similarities. And indeed, these textiles, these palimpsests, were imported into Europe beginning in the 17th century, but particularly in the 18th century, by the boatload, literally. And they show up in many European collections. They're more typically associated with Dutch and English taste, but you also found them in Italy. And so interesting to consider that potential influence. So in closing, this free port on the Adriatic coast, home to a prosperous and cosmopolitan community of Jewish traders and firmly controlled by a hostile papacy, provided perhaps unexpectedly just the right conditions for Viterbo's creative synthesis. And so we might consider how elements of Baroque garden design and Christian ecclesiastical vestments, botanical naturalism and Ottoman prayer rugs and embroidery coalesce in the handwork of this young woman who was confined to a ghetto, but really connected through textiles to networks of trade and exchange from London all the way to the Levant. And then I will end with a thank you and go out, stay in and embroider something. This is my sorry embroidery that was inspired by our palimpsest. So I know people have been going back into embroidery and handwork during the pandemic, and I encourage you to persist even as we get vaccinated.
That's great. I think it looks beautiful. I think you're doing a wonderful job. Okay, well, if there, I would encourage people, if you have questions, to please type them in to the Q&A area. Let's see. Oh, and we already have some popped up. So if you're ready for some questions, Jenny. Yeah.
Maybe I'll keep it in case we have to.
Yeah, go ahead and leave it there. Yeah, that'd be great. So one question is, did the item need conservation when purchased by the museum?
So it had been on long-term loan to the Israel Museum in Jerusalem, and they had stabilized it. And this is interesting. Miriam and I talked about this idea of aesthetic conservation. So that happens quite a bit in painting, but not so much in textiles, but a lot in fashion. So we had this sort of debate. Miriam, coming from the Costume Institute of the Metropolitan, was more familiar with for instance, replacing lost threads, attempting to revive metal that had been tarnished. There's a lot of new research now that had previously had been basically been impossible. And now there's more interesting research about how we might accomplish that in the future. So we did kind of debate, and then overall we decided that the wear was so even and not really that distracting that we would just leave it as is because it had been stabilized.
Sorry, can you say that last part again?
Because it had been stabilized.
Oh, okay. Thank
you. We're, you know, ready for exhibition.
Yeah, perfect. Okay, great. So I'm waiting for a couple more questions. We do have some people asking if this recording will be available. It will be available online in the coming weeks. It'll be on the museum's YouTube channel, but it'll be a few weeks. But I do have some other questions. So the textiles, and so all of the work that the Jewish women were doing, would that have been for sale outside of the ghetto? To the population of Ancona or even further, or were they only creating things for their, you know, for the people who lived in the ghetto, you know?
That's an interesting question. So the textile trade itself, that was also outside the ghetto. So the trades and improvements and things, from what I understand, was a much more, I don't want to say global, but kind of regional trade. Mm-hmm. And global trade in the sense too, because there are many Jewish traders as well, particularly Levantine traders. There's also some debate about the very, very skilled embroiderers like Simhah, if they were, if they had commissions from Christians, for instance. And most scholars suspect that, but there's no proof necessarily because those objects are not signed, right? So the great thing about these really beautiful synagogue textiles is they are signed and dated. So like samplers or other kinds of examples you can think of in Europe at this time, they really give you a sort of bird's eye view in, you know, or a much, it's really like a way to home in on this particular person and city.
Yeah.
So many other textiles from the 18th century are anonymous. We don't really know who made them.
Because, right.
But
yeah. Okay. Let's see, we have another question. What motivated the purchase of this item, and what other items are part of the collection reference? So I think you referenced a few that are in our collection, and those are actually currently on view right now, the objects that you showed in here, correct? The ones that are ours.
Yes. So there are several that are ours in the presentation that are included and signed in silk. And I do encourage you to see that because we don't have these textiles on view in perpetuity because they can only be shown really 1 year in 10 according to our conservation standards. So this is your chance potentially for 5 years. So we, in terms of our Judaica collection, we have Torah finials, which I showed. And then we have a contemporary glass piece as well. And so we're constantly building that. This was purchased really because of this wonderful fund. And we saw it in an auction catalog, you know, recognize how wonderful it is. It's fantastic to have a work signed by a woman in the 18th century as well, especially a Jewish woman in the 18th century. This was just such a great opportunity. And these textiles are exceedingly rare, particularly ones that are not, in very bad condition. So that can also be an issue. So, but we're constantly looking to grow the collection either through textiles or silver, ketubah, that would be really interesting too. So I think there's just a lot of room to grow.
Yeah, and it is such a beautiful condition. So I actually had another question about and you talked about the color a little bit as far as, you know, taking influence from other cultures or other textiles. Was there a significance to the colors that Simhah used in this? Like a religious, I guess, significance?
Yeah, so this was brought up to me in a different talk that this sort of turquoise color was a kind of a sacred color in Judaism. And I think actually Bill Setzer, one of our docents, was mentioning too this color blue as being a reference to the kind of sky and the sort of almost like much more research to think about that too. And then this color blue also was popular in the mid 18th century. So we actually have a few textiles in our collection from about 1850 or 1750 that are this same color too. So I think probably religious significance and possibly also, you know, a fashionable.
Right. It was in fashion. Yeah.
Yeah.
Great. All right. Well, I don't think we have any other questions, and I think we're at a good stopping point. So thank you so much. I really appreciate it. I think this was wonderful, and there's so awesome that we have so much information about this artist. And I want to thank everybody who's joined us today. If you'd like, I'd encourage you to register to join me on Thursday, May 13th at noon to hear the MFA Boston curator, Denise Doxey, speak about the exhibition Nubia, Treasures of Ancient Africa, which is currently on view at the museum as well. So if you're interested in that, you can go onto the museum's website under the events tab and you'll be able to register there. And thank you all and have a great day.